All right, so in this video we have a small scale that is going to be a 50-pound scale. We've got a 1280, and we have a simulator because we don't have any test weights. So what we're going to show is how to try to calibrate our scale using just a simulator. And please understand that this is, of the four different methods of calibration that we've looked at, this is the least accurate and is not something meant to be used in a legal for trade application. In certain situations where what you're doing is not legal for trade, this might be something that will take care of the job in a pinch, and the hopes would be that when you had the ability to come back and use actual test weights and get it honed in a little bit more accurately. So what we've got here, let's go through this. We've got our 1280 here, and we're going to start at a default situation, just so we know that it's not currently calibrated. That means we'll have to go in and set up our scale. So we're going to go ahead and do that quick. And this is going to be, as I said, a 50-pound scale. I'm going to set it up to be 50 pounds. And we're going to set it up to count by 0.01 of a pound. Okay, so at this point, we have that much done. So we'll go on to the calibration portion. Now, in order to calibrate with a simulator, there's some additional information that we need to know. While this might be the least accurate, and some folks might think it is, it's not the same as simply going from zero to span on the simulator, right? It's not that quick, fast, and easy. It's probably one of the more difficult methods of calibration, even though it's the least accurate, because it involves getting some data and doing some math. So what we need to find out is what is the excitation voltage that's being provided by the indicator, and we also need to know what the millivolt output is of the load cells in our system. Now, you could use a nominal 10 volts for the 1280, and in this case I have a nominal 3 millivolt per volt system here. But if we want to try to make this at least a little bit more accurate, we can truly measure what's being output, because it won't be exactly 10, and we can take the average of all of the load cells in our system and use those values for our calculations. So what we'll do to start is find out exactly what is our excitation voltage being output by the 1280. So I'm going to go ahead and turn on my meter here so that we're reading DC voltage. And my simulator here, my red and my black leads are my excitation voltage, so I'll just go ahead and put my leads into the simulator spots, and I see it looks like we're stabilizing out at 9.77 volts. So we just want to kind of keep track of things here, so let's go ahead and write that down. 9.77 volts is our excitation. Now, the next thing we need to know is the millivolt per volt values of the load cells in our system. And I've already went ahead and taken a look at these ahead of time. And we have four load cells here. And each of my four load cells is 3.001. I have two of them at 2.999. And one of them is at 3.004. And so what I want to do is actually take the average of those. And so if I sum these up, I get 12.003, divide that by 4, and that will actually give me 3.00075. Now, to determine what the full scale capacity is of the system, we would need to take the product of these two numbers here, my excitation and my average. So let's take a look at that. So if we do 9.77 and we multiply that by our 3.00075, that gives me a value of 29.3173275. Just write all those numbers down. So what that's telling me is that in this particular system here, my four load cells, they're 25 pounds apiece. And so that means I have a total load cell build of 100 pounds. So if this scale is experiencing 100 pounds, then when I measure my output with my voltmeter, I should be measuring 29.317 millivolts. And so that's an important factor when we're using the simulator in order to calibrate, because we want to make sure that the right amount reflects what it is that we're going to do. So with that in mind, let's go back to our calibration on the 1280. And of course, we're going to start with a zero calibration. So I'm going to go in here, hit calibrate scale. We'll do a standard cal. We're not using any hooks or chains at this point, so I'll just go ahead and hit next. And at our calibrate zero, what we want to do is we want to make sure that our voltmeter is outputting 0 millivolts. So I'm going to switch my leads from my excitation voltage to my signal output. And I see I'm a little high right now, so I'm going to adjust my voltmeter. And this is why it's really important here to make sure that you have a voltmeter that has a vernier and individual steps that you can use to try to dial in things precisely as you're working on it. So I've turned off my vernier, so that gives me a true zero immediately when I come down to the zero step on my simulator. So I've got a nice stable zero there. We'll go ahead and calibrate zero. So zero calibration is complete, so we'll go ahead and hit next. And for our span, remember this is a 50-pound scale. Even though we have 100 pounds of build due to the four 25-pound load cells, it's a 50-pound scale. That's how we're configuring this scale to be. So when we do our span calibration, we're going to set that weight value to be 50 pounds. So we'll enter 50 pounds here. And now we need to know, well, what would our millivolt per volt output be if we actually were putting 50 pounds on the scale? So that's where a little bit more math comes in here. So if we take a look at this, we set up a small ratio where we cross multiply. Try to think back to algebra in high school. And we say that 29.317 3275, if that corresponds with a full 100 pounds, remember that's the build, then that particular ratio needs to be the same as whatever that millivolt value is. We don't know what that is yet, so that's our variable, our x, related to 50 pounds. Okay? So what we're going to do is go ahead and cross multiply here. So we've got this 29.317 3275, which is still on my display. We're going to go ahead and multiply that by 50. And it gives us this value. So what we're doing here, we write this out. That's our cross multiplication. We take these two this crossway, multiply by these two this crossway, and they're equal to one another. So now I'm going to divide both sides by 100. So this answer gets divided by 100. And so this lets me know that at 50 pounds, which is what I'm setting as my span, that needs to be equal to 14.65866375 millivolts. So I need to make sure that that's what my voltmeter, my simulator says on here. So let's go ahead and do that. So I'm going to adjust my vernier here. We'll get ourselves kind of close, and then we'll dial it in with this. And this is why it's important. You can see I've stepped it up, and I'm a bit over where I need to be. I need to get down to 4.658. Well, here's another way you can see. This is one of the reasons why it's the least accurate method. Notice my voltmeter only goes out to one decimal place. So I'm missing out on a lot of precision here that I might be able to get with truly accurate test weights. So at best, I'm going to round this to 14.7. And so we can go ahead and just turn this down a little bit until our voltmeter matches what we need it to be. down here, 14 point, a little too far. And if we can get it right about to where it flips from 6 to 7, that should be the 6.5. And then we're going to be pretty close right about there. Okay, so we make sure that that's stable. Then we'll go ahead and calibrate our span. It says span calibration is complete, so we'll go ahead and hit next. We get our results, and we can hit finish. Now at this point, let's go ahead and save and exit. There we go. And as you can see, because we told the system in our calibration process that 14.7 millivolts was the equivalent to 50 pounds, that's indeed what it shows us on the display. But we need to get the simulator out of here and actually get our scale hooked up now at this point. So we're going to go ahead and swap our connectors out here quick. So now it's showing me some a different weight on the display, and that's actually the weight of our dead load. There's a platter on the top of the scale. There's some weight on the load cells, and it's kind of showing us what it's detecting with that. But this needs to be what our zero calibration actually represents. And so what we need to do here then is to go back into the unit and perform what's called a re-zero. And so we perform the re-zero in its empty state so that it can remove this value from both the zero and the span together to shift everything accordingly to accommodate for that. So let's hop back into our menu. Go to scales, we'll go to calibration. And right here you see we have this little option here called re-zero next to zero calibration count. So we're going to go ahead and press that re-zero. It lets us know to remove all the weight, so we don't have any weight on our scale at the moment. This is what's reflecting our zero, and then we'll press OK. Now we'll save and exit one more time. And now remember, we've just told it now that this is going to be zero, so we're going to see that zero weight. But because of the differences in the math that we've done and the resolution of the meter, you know, we used a simulator so we didn't properly get to exercise the scale or account for any environmental things with that kind of a calibration. So we expect that this isn't going to be perfect, but let's just see how the simulation cal here helped us out here. So I got a 1 pound test weight, and that gets us pretty close. We're at 0.99. But that's only 1/50th of our capacity. So as we put more weight on, we're going to see that ends up going to take us off a little bit more. So here's another 5 pounds. So we're off a little more. Here's another 10 pounds. And you can see that we start to get off a little bit more each time we calibrate, or add weight to this, rather. So you can see that this isn't the most accurate way to do it. This is why it's not a legal for trade option. It's clearly not going to pass a weights and measures inspection. But in a non-legal for trade situation, it might be enough to get you going in a pinch.